Hello, I'm Stuart Blore, carp fishing for me this week. I've got a number of sessions planned, and the opening one, I'm on a venue where I have caught before. Don't catch many, but when I do, they tend to be of a decent size, and that suits me. Anyway, the rods are out, I'm fishing on a platform, no bivvy at all tonight. The weather forecast is for a beautiful, dry, still night, and I'm trusting that one on this particular occasion. Anyway, I'm looking forward to what lies ahead. And as you can see, I'm stretched out on my bed chair, beatnik style. Not even any shoes required this evening. In fact, if I do get a fish, it'd be quite handy to just drop down off the platform into the water. It's very shallow and net it. So, let's see how it goes, shall we? I've now done a second night on the same venue, and again, unfortunately, I blanked. However, in my defence, we've had some very hot weather recently, and the weed has now become a pretty major issue, certainly in the shallows. And so I think I'll be giving that part of the lake a miss in the near future. Also though, and I did do the footnote after session one about the other anglers struggling, there were five anglers on the venue, all fishing for carp, some with three rods as well, good anglers into the bargain, and not one of us caught a single fish. So I think that, mind you, saying that, one small tench came out, but that brings everything into perspective, doesn't it? Not that we're in competition with other anglers, far from it, but it's good sometimes to see what other folks are catching, or in this case, aren't, because it helps us to keep our own catches and blanks in perspective. Anyway, you may notice behind me what looks like a wardrobe. Well, it is a wardrobe, but like Doctor Who's TARDIS, what it appears to be on the outside, when you open the doors and go in, it's something totally different. Shall we take a look? And there you have it. The doors are now open behind me. You can see better than Doctor Who's TARDIS. That's my fishing tackle wardrobe. And on the one side, I've kept the wardrobe side of things. I've got my clothes hanging up. That's my fishing clothes, of course. So I know where everything is when I want to go out on a session. Then beneath that, I've got a sack of seeds. Got some more clothes as well, as you can see. Got a couple of tubs. One contains pellets, the other contains ground bait, and a few items of tackle as well, making the most of the space that I've got in there. On the other side, that's where I keep my bait. As you can see, it's pretty well stocked at the moment. I've just had an order come in, and on the top shelf, I've got my dips. If you do follow my angling adventures on a regular basis, you'll know that I am a fan of dips, additives and dips. Got whiskey link in there, got corn steep liquor, and of course the various types of dip, of glug, that I use for adding an enhancer to the hook bait. And then below that, I've got my boilies. As you can see there, some of them are still in the boxes. I tend to work through them and keep them like that until I actually need them. And then on the third shelf, I've got pop-ups. I'm a great fan of pop-up boilies, and invariably whenever I'm tench, carp or bream fishing, I usually end up with a pop-up, if not on one rod, on both of them. So having them laid out like that, it enables me to see where I'm coming from in terms of stock level. Do I need to get another tub of something in? That sort of thing. It just helps you to see where you are. And then the next one, that's quite a full shelf at the moment. That's packed with pellets. And then finally at the bottom, again, that's another full one, isn't it? That's ground bait. I think it's good to get your bait, if it's possible, if you have the space, of course, to put it like that, because it's easy to see where you're at rather than having it all over the place, shoved at the back of a cupboard. You think you've got something, you go fishing, and then when you get your cupboard out, you realise that you didn't have what you thought you did, and it messes your fishing around. It's good to have everything laid out, like I've got, easy to see, if you have the space, of course, to do that. I'm into an early morning fish. I've been here all night. Conditions have been pretty good. But I haven't had anything at all. And here I am, first light, playing a fish. Feels decent enough. I'm not saying it's going to be a monster, but assuming I can land it, it's always better than a blank, isn't it? That's brilliant. It's always good to get the first one of the week on the bank, isn't it? My third session, a lot of anglers would say third time lucky. But I don't believe in luck, in life in general, and certainly as far as fishing is concerned. I think, yes, there's always that scenario where the guy who's never fished at all in his life is up against a really good angler, and he might catch more than him on that particular day. But over a period of time, 9 times out of 10, maybe even 99 times out of 100, the good angler will always outfish the one who perhaps doesn't have that same experience. And I think it goes for us in our own individual fishing. It's not about competition, it's not about us being better than anyone else. I think the more we develop our watercraft, the more we develop our understanding of what goes on beneath the surface of the water itself, the more we increase our chances of catching fish. So look, I don't think that really comes into it. I think it's all about us developing our own skills and our own abilities as anglers. The venue I'm on, the water is very clear, and I wanted to fish with mono rather than braid, which is my preferred hook length really when I'm after carp. But when it's very clear, I like to go for mono. The problem I've had in the past is that the hooks I've used with braid have been fine, but when I've paired them up with mono, they've snapped. I've tested them, not lost fish necessarily. I've tested them beforehand and they haven't really been up to it. But this particular hook pattern I've been using quite recently, it's a new one on the market, and I've been really pleased with it. And what's been especially pleasing about that fish is that I caught it on mono and that particular hook. So I think I've solved my problem there of what hook to use when I'm after carp and I want to go for a mono hook length. The bait that I used was a new one, first time I've used it, strawberry jam boily. I fished with a 16 mil, the hook was a size 4. And again, thinking about your fishing, working it all out. When you go to a water, don't just take your favorite bait, the one that you use everywhere else. Think about where you're going. Don't just think about what other anglers are using in the sense that you will follow the crowd, but think about what they're using so you can actually try something different. And I wanted to try that, so I have done so, and it's worked, and it's always good, isn't it, when a plan comes together. Well, they like the strawberry jam for breakfast. It's the second fish of the session. Amazing, isn't it? Been here all night, not a tap, nothing at all. And then within the space of an hour, a couple of fish. That's angling for you, isn't it? Before I cast out, let's have a look at my rig. Well, there's the boilie. It's been soaking in strawberry jam dip. And of course, you can see the hook there. The hook length is about 8 inches, which is the maximum I would go for carp, really. And there you can see the swivel is inside that bead system there. I've got a lead. In this instance, it's 2 ounces. And then I've got a small 5 mil bead there, and above it I've got a float stop. So I pull the float stop down so it creates a fixed lead. But, and this is very important, you have to produce, if you do something like that, you have to produce something that is very, very safe. Now, on this occasion, if you ever fish with these, you'll know how much they slip. They don't hold at all. In fact, when I caught the two fish previously, the stop was well up the line, and that was just with the effect of the lead against it. So, in the unlikely event that I did have a break above there, what would happen is that would just come off with minimum pressure. That's very, very important. Anyway, you see my rig, simple, isn't it? Simple but effective. I was just thinking to myself, stretched out on the bed chair, I'm doing well on these strawberry jam boilies this morning, but what about the other rod? A couple of 10 mil M2 boilies popped up, they're bottom baits on the strawberry jam, and just as I was thinking it, the rod went off on a screamer. And this feels like a better fish than the other two, although they've been okay, haven't they? I'm just happy to catch. I'm really pleased with that fish. It was absolutely solid, and the shoulders on it were amazing. It had really broad shoulders. You saw that as you looked down in the net. Not you, but me. I didn't get that on film. Anyway, I'm really pleased with that, and it was actually caught on a braided hook length, which just goes to show, doesn't it, my comments earlier about mono being the main line of attack. I actually fished braid on one, and that's a good thing about two rods. You can experiment if you like. And as it's worked out, although I've had the quantity on the mono, I've actually had the quality on the braid. Angling is full of surprises, and that's the great thing, isn't it, about it. You just never know what's around the corner. Well, I really enjoyed that. I hope you've enjoyed watching the video as well. It just shows, doesn't it, that we have to persevere. I did two nights without a fish. Actually, you could say three nights without a fish, because those three came right at the very end in daylight. It just shows, doesn't it, that there's a difference between being stubborn and persevering and sticking at it. And as anglers, we need to be on the right side of that line. Anyway, it all worked out for me, and I'm a happy bunny, as they say. This is the first video on a new channel. It's all in HD, so the quality that you watch, if you go onto a TV or whatever, it's all real good quality. If you like it, why not subscribe? And why not share the video as well? I always appreciate it when folks do that. And if you want to read the blog that accompanies the video, then you'll find the link to that in the description box and the comments box here on YouTube. I've been writing a blog since July the 5th, 2003. That was a Saturday, and I've done every single Saturday since. I haven't missed a week. People say that's dedication, that's commitment. Yes, I suppose it is, but it's also a labour of love. I'll see you next week.